And we're back. So what? You're listening to the Talking Boxing with Billy C Show right here on Fox Sports Radio, WMML 1230. Glad all you guys could join us. Don't forget, February 28th, JKJ Boxing is doing another event at the Holiday Inn in Syracuse, New York. Get yourself some tickets by visiting their website, www.jkjboxing.com, and clicking on the events button. But, you know, one of our favorite segments each week is
Blast from the Past. We shine the spotlight again on fighters from years past.
Joe Louis is the leading contender.
And upset by Mr. Carver, be the greatest.
Joe Frazier with a left hook.
Good right hand thrown by Foreman that time.
Look at that left
that
hook.
That belt that goes to Ray Mancini.
It's Blast from the Past on Talking Boxing.
Yeah, even though my little intro was breaking up a little bit there, but this week's Blast from the Past is being sponsored by the International Boxing Organization, where their computerized ranking system is second to none. Features Ad Wolgast. Now, Ad Wolgast was a former world champion, and he's a Boxing Hall of Famer. And joining me, like he does every week, to tell us all about this guy, my man Alex Perpalli. What's up, brother?
Hey, Billy C. Yeah, we've got a good one this week.
Oh, I knew you were going to like this guy. It actually came at a good time, but following last week's, right? I mean, they're kind of parallel, but tell us about Ad.
Yeah, Ad Wolgast. I think it goes great with last week, absolutely. Because we had Packy McFarlane last week, and Ad Wolgast from the same era, and I don't see that they ever fought, but they did get some close. And it always seemed to fall apart just days beforehand. And like Packy McFarland was the stylist, this is the slugger. And wow, what a slugger. This guy is just about as tough as they come. Ad Wolgast, it's actually a short. Ad is short for the, what now is an unfortunate name of first name of Adolf, for obvious reasons. But at this time, no one had ever heard of a Hitler when he was in his prime. He was born February 8, 1888, in Cadillac, Michigan. And he was 5'4½", small, scrappy guy. And he fought mostly, some of his featherweight, mostly as a lightweight. That's where he really did his serious damage. And that's what I'm talking about. When you talk about Ad Wolgast, you got to talk about damage, because he was a fighter. And I tell you, Billy C, we did another guy not too long ago. I never knew being a paper boy was such a tough racket, because it's very likely that's one of the things where he started fighting. As a kid, he sold newspapers. And, you know, the newspaper boys would have a little beat. You know, you'd have your neighborhood of where you sold papers. So I guess if somebody was coming into your area, there's only one way to settle it. Back then, you use your fist. I mean, today, everybody probably is carrying a 9.
Yeah. And you know what? You know what else? It's true. You're 100% right. The newspaper kids, you know, a lot of them learned how to fight on the street, protecting their area. But you know what else was, not to get off the subject, but shoeshine boys, too. They had they had their areas, too, and they would fight, you know, to maintain their customer base as well, man. It was, you know, people think times are tough now. It was definitely tough back then. There's no question.
Absolutely. And I tell you, it is one of those things where, you know, boxing was a way out, a way to make money quickly and to make serious money. In a way, it was easy money when you were a tough kid, you know. Two of his brothers were boxers as well, Al Wolgast and Johnny Wolgast. He was the oldest of 7 kids, so I would think just getting a meal.
To fight for the potatoes was a battle. You know, I mean, you know, just to get a glass of water at the table, he had to fight his way.
Exactly, know? For seconds, it's a struggle. But I guess at some point he moved early to Milwaukee and started fighting out of Milwaukee. He had a couple of different nicknames: the Cadillac Kid, the Michigan Wildcat, his style was just pure violence. Robert Randolph Sugar, one of our favorites. He has him listed in his book as number 81 as of the greatest boxers of all time. And, yeah, he really goes on about how he wasn't the kind of guy with a lot of defense. His defense was his face. And sometimes he actually would lead with his face. Like his forehead to your shoulder was, you know, that was like part of his arsenal. But he was a brawler, you know, pretty hard puncher. He wore guys down, incredible durability, incredible stamina. Again, this is the age where you could have fights that were scheduled for 20 rounds, for 40 rounds, and he certainly, you know, was able to best guys over those long hauls.
Yeah, and they also fought a fight to the finishes. He fought a lot of big names we've heard of, Frankie Neal, Abe Attell, you know, early in his career, Owen Moran, but big names too, like Battle and Nelson, which was another guy that had a similar style. We all learned about his fortitude when he fought Joe Gans and stuff, but he had some great fights with Ad Wolgast, and of course the famous fight with Mexican Joe Rivers we'll get to in a second. But he won the title, according to my records, in 1910. When he fought Battling Nelson in Point Richmond, 40 round. This was a fight to the finish for a title, and he knocked out Nelson in the 40th round in that one to win the title.
Yeah, and that really was just an incredible fight, and parts of it are available on YouTube. I will tweet them and post them in the Facebook group for the show, because it's definitely worth a look. I read one report that there was some sort of stipulation in terms of fouls, that fouls were allowed. That's how rough these two guys were. And I mean, this was like, to call it a Gotti Ward is, I think, a disservice to it, because you're talking about two of the best lightweights on earth at the time. Just so happens their styles don't involve much science. They're both troglodytes. So that's what you got, was just a brawl. And there was a point where Battling Nelson almost knocked out Wolgast in round 23.
I know.
And he sort of half-dropped him. And, you know, referee Ian John Lewis would have certainly waved the bout off. But Wolgast sort of went down partially on his knees. This is described better than you could see it in the video. Is described in newspaper reports. And as he goes down, Nelson throws up his hands like, "I won." And then Wolgast literally pulls himself up along Nelson's body. He grabs on him and pulls himself up, and the fight continues.
Well,
and yeah, it ends up stopping in round 40-40.
Yeah,
the referee rescues Nelson.
Yeah, well, I was wrong. It wasn't a fight to the finish. It was scheduled for 45 rounds, but the stoppage was amazing. They you know, because Battle of Nelson really throughout that fight, according to most reports, was in control. I mean, he seemingly was getting the better of Wolgast. But in the 40th round, Nelson's damage started taking a toll on him. And, you know, how you see, we just recently saw it. How many fingers am I holding up? You know, four?
Right,
you know,
right.
No, you're out, right? Well, you know, they gave them a lot more of a benefit of the doubt back then. But this time, Battle of Nelson couldn't hide the fact he couldn't see much, because the report of this says after the 40th round, his vision was so impaired that when he was ready to begin, he was fighting facing the wrong end of the ropes. He couldn't even see which direction he was supposed to go in. And the referee said, I better stop this fight. So pretty amazing that they even let it go that far.
Oh, yeah. This was definitely a completely different age than today. And sadly, we will see that a lot of these, the brutality of his fights did take an incredible toll on him, and actually on Battling Nelson as well. But yeah, that was one of the things I did want to mention, was that it sounds like he had, the word that kept coming up was, quote, unruly, end quote. That he was a bit of a troublemaker, I guess. At one point in 1910, in May of 1910, he actually ran over a 12-year-old girl with his car. This is 1910, okay? So she was on horseback, and he was driving, and I guess her horse startled and came into the lane, and he nailed her, and I guess damaged her leg, broke her leg, and then he picked her up, put her in the car, and brought her to her home, and it's almost started like a feud between him and the father. But I guess, you know, the girl's brother was able to calm things down. Calm the irate merchant. This was from the New York Times of 1910. But yeah, that was an interesting little snippet I saw about him. And then also I was wondering...
Wait a minute. Alex, what happened to the horse?
I don't know. They don't mention what happened to the horse.
Yo, man, you know...
I have to think that the horse got pretty damaged too, no?
Yeah, well, you know, let's hope we don't get any calls from PETA or anything.
I know. Yeah, PETA was not around at that time.
But maybe that horse started it all. But anyway,
I'm
go ahead.
Guessing the horse was shot on sight.
Yeah. Its new name was Alpo, you know, but anyway, go ahead. I'm sorry. I couldn't let that go.
There was another thing in terms of, you know, these little, you know, I like all the odd, terrifying tragedies. There was another point where he woke up screaming, and this was actually one of the things that ended the Packy McFarland fight. Because I was going to say earlier that they had a common opponent. Remember we were mentioning Packy McFarland had fought Freddie Welch. Well, he had fought Freddie Welch as well. Welch beat him and had him cut and bleeding, and that was the thing. You could outbox him. So I think it would have been interesting to see if McFarlane and Walgast ever fought. That's like a Pacquiao-Mayweather fight of 1910, 1912 that, you know, nobody ever saw. But one of the reasons it was canceled was he woke up in the morning screaming from a burst appendix. And we know from how Pancho Villa went out. Back then, a medical emergency could end it for you.
Right.
But he handled it well. He also, the newspaper said that he tried to refuse anesthesia. And a tough guy like that, you'd think maybe he could get through appendicitis operation without anesthesia.
I don't know. Getting anesthesia was pretty tough back then, too. You never knew what you were going to come out. What was worse, the appendix or having somebody pull your tooth, remember?
I know. But, they said all they did was hold a sponge against his nostrils. Oh, there God. You go. He's out.
Yeah, jeez. Well, let's talk about the fight that really got a lot of publicity, even in those triumph times. In 1912, he fought Mexican Joe Rivers, which was a kind of a unique situation there. You want to tell us about that fight?
Yeah, Joe Rivers. That you know, we've seen a couple of them, and I actually was live for one that the referee Dick Flaherty missed. Actually, it was back on an old Showbox card. It was a double knockdown. And it was, Sekou Powell versus Cornelius Bundridge and in the first round. Well, against Joe Rivers, that's what happened with Ad Walgast and Joe Rivers. Mexican Joe Rivers was his moniker. And this is one of those things, Bill, that if we had today, if people don't realize how lucky we are, there's so much subjectivity to this sport, and a lot of it has to do with because it happened so quickly, and you got to figure there was only one angle, evidently, and I don't see—I didn't see it, but people described it in the newspapers that I read. That you can't really tell what happens, but towards the that's how the fight ends. Rivers connects with a shot at the same time that Walgast connects with a shot that most people seem to agree was low. A shot in the groin. Both guys went down on top of each other, out of it. The referee decided that Walgast, being on top of the pile, was the winner.
Yeah, but he helped him up. That's the whole part of it. He helps him up. He brushes him off. He practically gives him a sip of water.
It was sort of a double knockdown that the ref ruined.
Yeah. You know, they both fighters get knocked down. And we've heard Larry Hazard talk about this. You know, I mean, it was actually an issue that we brought up on the show. But in this particular case, and then ultimately, the end of the story is it started a riot. There was a riot after this and everything else. But the bottom line is the referee, you know, starts counting out the other guy. They're both laying on the ground, and he's counting out Mexican Joe Rivers, and he's helping up Ad Walgast, you know. So, I mean, you know, I could see why the fans got a little upset, you know. I mean, you can't really blame him.
I'd love to see it because, I mean, how much was he helping him up? You know, was he helping him up because he was just trying to get to the bottom of the pile, or was he trying to favor Walgast? You know, and I think that's one of those things that it happened so quick, you know, people react and boom, you know, there's no replay to see what exactly happened.
Yeah, but the round, how about
replay? Sometimes you still can't tell.
But the round before that, or actually in the 10th round or something, I believe. Mexican Joe Rivers was Ad Walgast was getting a good old fashioned can of whoop ass on him on that night, and he didn't even want to come out. I think at the beginning of the 13th round, he didn't want to come out. His own corner was threatening to beat him with the water bottle. That was glass. It wasn't plastic. And he went out. He went out to fight Mexican Joe Rivers rather than get beat up by his own corner. And then this happens, you know. And you wonder why the fans were crazy. You know, Mexican Joe Rivers, by a lot of accounts, claimed that he had one of his best nights as a professional that night against Ad Walgast, and he ends up getting counted out. Why both of them were laying on the ground? It's kind of a unique situation. We think we have crazy stuff going on now. That's nothing compared to then.
Yeah, and I think it is one of those situations where, you know, sometimes remaining a champion, becoming a champion or remaining a champion is, you know, it's something questionable. You know, whether it's a decision like De La Hoya versus Felix Sturm, you know, or you get the better of a very questionable referee call. Sometimes that's how you hold on to your title, because one guy's got to win, another guy's got to lose.
Well, now the juicy stuff, the part that you liked about this guy the best, I'm sure. As he continued, that Mexican Joe Rivers fight took place in 1912. He continued on with success, of course, fighting all the top names. He did eventually fight Mexican Joe Rivers again, and ironically enough, that fight was a draw. He fought Battle of Nelson again, and all big names, but somewhere around 1917, he had only fought one time, and he was knocked out, and things started happening with him mentally. And as a matter of fact, he was deemed unfit to control his own life, basically, and they had declared that he was incompetent, and his wife, I believe, was given guardianship and was in charge of his affairs. He suffered a nervous breakdown, and he went into a sanitarium. Now, ultimately, from what I read, that he was eventually let out, that he proved by someone's standard that he was okay to handle his own affairs, which maybe was a mistake at that time. He came out, got his affairs back in his hands, and continued his boxing career that just spiraled downward after that.
Yeah, and it really was a point where he certainly should not have been fighting, because from what they're talking about, when he was determined to be unfit, it seems like, I mean, his whole life seemed to come apart. He was put into a sanitarium, and then he escaped from one of them, or one or two of them. He went through a divorce after his wife was put in charge of all his affairs. They ended up divorcing. I'm sure the stress of the whole thing was probably pretty difficult. He eventually was given over to the care of a guy named Jack Doyle, who I'm not sure. I didn't get a chance to look him
up.
Well,
he was a promoter. That was the sad part of the ending of that. But if you think it could get any sadder. But just like you alluded to earlier, his style, his all-attack style where he came out, you know, he suffered a lot of injuries, not only to his head, but he had many broken bones in his forearms and elbows and stuff that never healed right. He had the, you know, the look of a fighter, pushed-in nose, the cauliflower ears, and all that stuff. When he got his estate back from his wife, who he divorced, you know, considering just like last week with Packy McFarland, this guy made a lot of money too. You know, we're talking about the early 1900s. You know, he had $150,000 in the bank, you know, which was a lot of money back then. I mean, a lot of money back then, considering people were working for a couple of dollars a week, you know, $2 or $3 a week is what the salaries were, you know, and this guy had $150,000 in the bank, you know. So once he was let out, he did try to fight one more time in 1920, where he ended up fighting a four-round draw, and then everyone realized that, you know, he was definitely a little cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs, and he was put in the guardianship of Jack Doyle, who was a promoter. And then for the rest of his life, pretty much, until he got put back into the sanitarium, he trained diligently under the watchful eye of Jack Doyle, who kept telling this guy, and this is where it was sad. I guess he was looking out for his own good. I would have to assume that. I hope, because I didn't read that he took all his money or anything like that. All I found was that, you know, Jack Doyle made sure he had a place to stay and let him train in his gym, which Ad Wolgast did, you know, diligently every day, and was in great shape. And Doyle kept saying, yeah, we're going to get to your fight tomorrow. And the fight never came. It never materialized. He ended up again getting committed to another mental hospital, where his end was kind of strange, wasn't it?
And that was one of the things, is that I think part of that, the training, constantly training, I think he was sort of hallucinating. He believed that they were going to have another rematch with Battling Nelson. And you're right, there was something sort of bittersweet to that, because even though Doyle sort of let him go, sort of propagated the lie, in a way, it was a noble lie. He needed to believe in something, and a fighter wants to train like he's going to be doing something. The sad thing about it, he had no short-term memory. So, you know, within a couple of hours, you're telling him again, yeah, we're going to fight him. And who are we fighting tomorrow? You know, so, I mean, that's one of those things where as much as this guy must have thrilled crowds, it did take a savage toll on his life after boxing. And you're right, he did go through, I'm not sure how, if he really, it sounds like he made some bad investments. He bought a couple of racehorses that I guess didn't do so well, and he had made some investments. But you're right, then he ended up being sort of benefiting from, when his father died, he was left a lot of money. But yeah, it did become where it sounds like he died in an institution, in relatively good physical condition, because there was even a point where he was living in a hotel in 1949. He was in his 60s. He was still in pretty good shape. There was a lot of times he would get combative, and again, that word kept coming up, unruly. He believed he was still, a fighter, and he got beaten up by two men that worked in one of the hotels. And it's interesting, because when I read it somewhere else, I saw that they called them guards at a sanitarium, but there was somewhere else where I saw it. It sounded like maybe it was a halfway house or something, I don't know. But he certainly was in rough shape. He recovered well from that, so physically he was in good shape, but his brain was mush. And he eventually just died of a heart attack in a sanitarium.
Yeah, you know, and the story that I heard about, I thought it took place in a sanitarium. I didn't know that it was in another place. I thought that he was in there, and, you know, some of the orderlies, I saw the same thing. They referred to him as guards. Didn't realize who he was or whatever, and just thought they thought he was a tough guy, and they wanted to teach him a lesson, so they beat him up, you know, which is so absurd, you know. I mean, back then, those hospitals were tough, man. You wouldn't want to get sent to one of those. And I just, that's the kind of stuff that really bothers me in life, Alex. I can't stand people that would do that, to someone, regardless of who the person is and regardless of what the situation. I mean, you know, hey, this guy thinks he's a tough guy. Let's beat his ass. You know, I mean, that's to me, that's a scourge human being. You know what I'm saying? And
oh, yeah, especially, you know, he's an older, elderly man, and they were two young people that jumped him. And it did say they did face charges.
Yeah, and the first rumor was, so he must have died not too long after that. It must have been at least the same year or within 6 months, because the first report said that he actually died from that beating, and then it was corrected and said, no, he died of a heart failure, and he was 67 years old. So, you know, it makes you wonder, you know, what life was like for him after 1920, because, you know, that for those 35 years, you know, he was living, you know, kind of like Groundhog Day. Like you said, his short-term memory
right.
was shot.
And I think probably a little bit like a Blanche DuBois life, where he's sort of relying on the courtesy of strangers, because at some point him and Doyle did split. And again, that word unruly came up. So I guess he was difficult to manage. You got to think that he probably would. If he's thinking in his mind that he's, you know, in his 20s and he's in a body that just won't respond, and the frustration he must feel, it must have been difficult. It was a real sad end.
You know, the thing, you know, when I don't want to jump off the subject here, but you see, and this is where I kind of understand, like, a guy like Floyd Mayweather. And what I mean by that is, the history of boxing, although it's so rich, and we look at it as guys like Ad Wolgast, you know, what he gave basically his life, his brains, you know, to this sport, you know, in during that era and what it's evolved to today. A guy like Floyd Mayweather is conscious enough where he doesn't want to end up like that, you know, and you know, his way of not ending up like that is to fight, you know, careful fights and don't get in there too tough and all of that, which is smart in a sense. But on the other hand, it kind of does what we complain about from him and other fighters that do that, about the basis of the sport. And it makes you wonder, you know, is it a smart move on his part, or is it a disrespectful move for guys like Ad Wolgast, you know?
Right. Yeah, I think that's a good question. I think the answer is maybe it's a little bit of both.
True.
Because you're right. To put himself in the same class, it is kind of hard to do that, hard to swallow when you look at the amount of fights this guy had. However, when you think, well, this is a new age, and shouldn't we benefit from the science that what we've learned? And in that sense, Floyd's, you know, smart. But I think one of the things you could learn from Ad Wolgast's career that, you know, probably even fighters at the time could have, was that he did a lot of his learning in the ring. And that was one of the things I read at some point. After one of his fights, he had a broken arm. He was the kind of guy that he didn't know if that arm's better until he fights with it. You know, so, I mean, he could go, and I think that kind of combat was everything to a lot of the guys we talk about in the Blast from the Past. And I think today the modern athlete spends a lot of time preparing and conditioning themselves in the gym, and I think that's a major difference in the sport itself.
It's true, but a lot of people don't understand. They have to do that today because they fight so infrequently. You know,
yeah.
a guy, you know, we're jumping for joy if a fighter, you know, an established fighter, fights four times a year. We're ready to give him Fighter of the Year award because he fought four times a year. Now, back then, they might have fought an average of three times a month, twice a month, definitely. Some guys, you know, Sam Langford fought sometimes twice in a week, you know. But the difference was that they weren't fighting, you know, these knockout, drag-out Mexican Rivers, Joe Rivers types fights every time. They would sprinkle in, you know, some of the lighter showcase, the way we refer to them today, showcase fights to stay busy. That's how they made their living. But when, you know, you shake it all down, these guys, you know, did fight a lot more, and they sparred a lot less because they were in the ring more. They were earning a living. You know, they had to make their money in the ring. That was how they made their money. So the game has changed a lot. And, you know, my big hang-up with today's fighters and the carefully, you know, the strategies of how to not fight tough fighters and get a title and all these belts. To me, it's disrespectful to these guys. You know, these the Ad Wolgasts, the all the forefathers, so to speak, of the sport that really gave you and I know because we research it, we learn about these guys, and it's more than a lot of people realize. You know, like what they gave up. You know what their sacrifices were. Way more. I mean, even a guy, you know, that never made a championship, you know, that never won a world title, sacrificed his whole life, you know, for the sport. And it's a shame that it's not the same still, you know.
It's true. And it's the kind of stuff that that gets Jim Lampley to get all choked up and turn on the waterworks.
Yeah.
These guys don't know what kind of a champion really is.
Yeah. Well, you know, I mean, sometimes I got to agree with him. I mean, it's true, you know.
He's right. Yeah, I'm with you. I hear you.
You know?
I just don't turn on the waterworks so easily.
No. Not unless it, you know, it happens to a kitty or something like that. Then it's a different story, right?
Yeah, Jim, it doesn't take much.
Yeah, but anyway. All right. Title bout. Who'd you put him in?
So I put him in the title bout. This was an easy one because there's only one guy. It's pretty undisputed at lightweight. And where the hell did I put the results? Oh, hey there. There's only one guy to put him in there against, ranked numero uno at lightweight on the BillyCBoxing.com rankings, is Terrence Crawford. So I put them in together, Ad Wolgast versus Crawford. And in the first fight, it was a very good fight. As you would assume, they matched up pretty well. And, I mean, Wolgast is the kind of guy, he's going to bring it. So anybody who, you know, is going to stand there and fight him, it's going to make for a pretty entertaining fight. And Crawford was dropped in the ninth and then stopped at 55 seconds of round number 11. He really just, you know, was faced with a... And I think this is the kind of guy that he'd be hard to train against because so much of it, his punches were probably always coming from weird angles because so much of it was sort of this naturalistic pressuring, punching style. So I then had them fight 100 times, and yes, our Blast in the Past did very well. He got the better of Terrence Crawford, 64 wins, 31 defeats, 5 draws. He stopped Crawford 22 times, and of the wins, of the 31 wins that Crawford had, he was able to knock out Wolgast 11 times.
You know, it makes me wonder. This is a great example. These two fighters that you just put in the title bout championship computer game, Ad Wolgast, that we just described to everybody as just a come at you. I'm using the face block as my defense, and I'm hitting you as much as I can, as hard as I can, you know, wherever I can. And we look at Terrence Crawford. We all love Terrence Crawford because he definitely displays the sweet science. He's got, you know, the boxing ability to use his jab, and he's got great footwork and mobility, but he also is not afraid to exchange. And this is the question I always ask myself, you know, when you make up those dream matchups, oh, if Floyd could have fought this one, or if Tommy Hearns could have fought that one, or whatever, you know, you always say, well, you know, the biggest thing that lacks today are these style guys, the Ad Wolgast, the Rocky Marcianos, the guys that come at you, the same statements that we always say, oh, how do you beat Vladimir Klitschko? All you got to do is get underneath the jab and work the body and then go for the knockout. Well, everybody says that, but nobody seems to be able to do it. Now, my question is always, is it because these fighters are so good, or... is it because we don't have these types of fighters with this type of mentality that Ad Wolgast have, where he's willing to eat that punch to get in to do his type of damage? And I think the title bout championship computer game reflected that with the results that you had.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think that's one of the things, especially in this country, that's a problem that boxing definitely faces, because there's been so many... inner city gyms that have just been dissolved or have been forced to close. I think a lot of those really good trainers who looked at the sport as a craft and taught the craft to kids are gone. So yeah, you have people who, you know the basic moves and stuff, but that idea of You know, and actually, I wouldn't, I don't know, part of me, because at the same time, I can't help but think that that fight just recently on Friday Night Fights when Tony Luis upset, who was it, Dargan?
Yeah.
Carl Dargan?
Yeah.
He fought him in a very old-fashioned style, where he just sort of, by about the third round, he changed, he forced his style on Dargan so much that the fight was basically fought cheek to cheek, jowl to jowl, and he was just chopping away at Dargan, and Dargan couldn't use any distance, couldn't really use the sweet science, or at least in the way he applies it, and Luis broke him down. I think that was a very old-fashioned victory that we've seen recently, but you're right, for the most part, we don't see that too often.
Well, you're right, and the reason is, there's two reasons. Number one, you're right about the trainers. We don't have teachers anymore. What we have now, and I've said it a lot of times, is rah-rah men. Now, what the rah-rah men bring to the table and why they're even in this position is because today, because of technology and what we've learned scientifically, they've become nutritionists. They know what to eat. They know how to work out. They know how to work specific muscles and you know, get the best performance out of a human body, etc. They're great at that. We didn't have that, you know, 20, 50, 75, 100 years ago. But they're not teachers. They're not boxing teachers. So they're learning all of this end of it. And when they get into the corner, they're basically rah-rah. Go out there and get them, but don't get hit. Don't just, you're not hearing any, you know, real criticism. You know, you're not hearing any things that would indicate that they actually know what they're talking about, you know, when it comes to boxing. The other part of it, with the great example that you gave with Dargan and Luis, was the fact that you know, these guys, the Dargans, those boxers, that style, when you spar with them, you're not allowed to do what he got done to him when he lost that fight. You're not allowed to put pressure on him. You're not allowed to rough him up. So he's never seen it. He didn't have an answer. It was obvious that Dargan didn't have an answer for that kind of aggression. You know, he didn't know what to do. And when he went back to his corner, they didn't know what to do. You know, it was he was beaten by lack of experience. I can't sit here and say that I thought that Dargan, you know, was the less skilled of those two, but he was beaten because he just didn't have the knowledge, and neither did the rest of his team, you know, and these coddling these fighters, that's what you risk all the time, you know. You don't have the Adwalgas anymore that's going to bring that out in you, at least learn how to defend against it.
Right, that's something that, that's the kind of thing that you're right. I mean, he would have needed to learn that in the gym, where it just was one of those things where the trainer would say, look, back up to the ropes and stay there, and I want you to get out of this. I just want to have sparring partners put pressure on you in close.
Right.
And, you know, make him learn that. And you're right, it probably was never done.
No, because they don't want to risk getting him hurt. So
yeah.
so let's say, and the exact example you gave is what they used to do. They used to say, okay, you know, what we want you to do is we're going to have a guy come and he's going to put all this pressure on you. We want you to learn how to spin out of that pressure and get out of harm's way. Okay, we want you to either grab him or spin him or use a punch to, you know, ring generalship. I mean, we're always wondering what is ring generalship? Well, that's ring generalship. Something like that, where you neutralize somebody's strength at a critical time in the fight. And that's something that we don't see anymore. And we don't see it because we don't have those teachers, those trainers. And what do we get? We got guys that can't even cut the ring off. And they're considered a world champion. They don't even know how to cut the ring off. You know, how does that happen? You know, it happens because we have 100 gazillion titles and everybody's got a belt. You know, and when people say, oh, the more belts, the better, that's where I laugh. How, you know, the end result is what we're talking about right now.
Yeah, it's a consistent watering down the more belts that you get.
Adwalgas, Alex, great job. Adwalgas had a career record, 59 wins, 40 coming by knockout. He had 13 losses in which he was only stopped three times. He had 17 draws. Now, he had a total of 140 pro fights because he fought in a newspaper decision, so he was about 50-50 there. 22 wins, 21 losses, 6 draws. That's kind of tough to really hold against the guy because those newspaper decisions were based on opinion, and depending upon which newspaper you wrote for would depend on who you picked in the fights. He had 1,136 rounds as a pro with a 30% knockout ratio, and like Alex had mentioned, he was only 5'4.5". He did have a 65.5-inch reach, and he died at 67 years old. In that unfortunate manner in which we talked about before. He was a former world lightweight champ, and he was inducted into the International Boxing Hall of Fame in the year 2000. Ad Wolgast, our blast from the past this week, and Alex, great job as usual on that one.